will know that when I joined ECB ACO, I was effectively recruited from the Oval Ball Game, which I'm still involved with, but at that time I was obviously more involved with rugby. And as a rugby referee, we moved some time ago from the amateur era, where we were amateurs, to the professional era, where we were playing. And at that time, we engaged a psychologist to help us with that transitional change. That was when I first met this gentleman on my right-hand side, Dave Collins, who was effectively at that time the psychologist or the coaching official psychologist for the elite group of rugby referees that was. You'll see from the notes that you've got in your program that I'm not going to repeat here, that he has a very high academic background, a very high standing in the world of psychology, and particularly sports psychology. You can get where you've got friends and enemies and all that sort of thing. I have invited him today because, of course, the first session of this has traditionally been to do with psychology. Those of you who've been here before, we've had Raj Purser, we've had Jeremy Snape, but we've now invited the top academic sports psychology professionals in the field. So I'm delighted that he's agreed to join us. I know you will be informed and entertained. Please welcome David Collins. Professor David Collins.
Always feel daunted by introductions like that. I remember President Johnson talking about such an introduction and saying how he wished his parents could have been here to hear it, because his father would have loved it and his mother might have believed it, but there you go. I've got Mike round the back. Everybody's called Mike, which is very useful, yeah? There's another mic there. So anyway, never mind. We'll press the button and see. Oh my gosh, it does. Please, ladies and gentlemen, don't take this the wrong way. By the way, everything's going to be very visual. So if you're a long way back, I hesitate to suggest that anybody, any umpire would be visually challenged. But if you are, no. Not hearing me is great. That's fine. You know, you're probably, people will be paying you for the seat. But if you can't see, my halitosis has virtually cleared up. So please feel free to sit close to the front. So without further ado, it's been a long AGM, and I know it's a long day. So let me just start with some inspiration from top class sport. Watch in slow motion. Oh. Now, I'd like right up front to say that they're not my clients. I'm not that bad. I had the pleasure for a few years of being performance director of athletics, and one of my pole vaulters actually landed on his pole and had to have 18 stitches in his scrotum. We called him Frodo because his ring had been destroyed. But anyway, moving right along. So what have we got? I'm going to take you through five quick Flashers Mac trips, and appropriately enough, we're going to start with this thing, the flash lag effect. Don't worry, it's nothing to do with umpires with long coats. What this is to do with is the capacity for you to do two or more things at once. So the capacity for you to be in line to see, is this guy's bat going to cross the line as this guy does this? Yeah, or if I'm in an offside situation, is this player onside when the ball was passed? And this is a very common psychological effect. It's one of the things that's crucial to what you do. And everybody in here must have mastered a technique, and I'll come back to that in a minute, a technique for mastering this psychological challenge. Let's have a look at that. So if we can run, Mike, please, the first bit of video. Gosh, this is working well. Well done, Mike. So pretty much what we're asking you to do is to look at these two things and see when they're aligned. But because one's going to move and the other one's going to flash up, pretty much what you're doing is looking at one, then looking at the other, looking at one, looking at the other. And when you do that, the other one will have looked to move. And even if you're in line, it's somewhat hard to see if these things are aligned. Now, in actual fact, this is an artificial situation. They're actually always aligned. Yeah, and that's the point, that in this situation, the batsman would be safe, the player that would be onside, but because of the fact that your eye is drawn from one thing to another and back, all of a sudden, the serial processing, you're doing this, then this, then this, means that they're not. If we go on to the next one, things get even worse when the background's moving. This is a thing that we're currently doing a lot of work with special forces on. When they walk into a room and everything else is moving and they've got to draw a bead, they're moving, the target's moving, and they've got to draw a bead and shoot that target. So these two things look in line, that's great, but now all of a sudden, see the effect? Seems to drag it one way or drag the other. And these are hardwired things, ladies and gents. There's not much you can do about this. But they're challenges that you have to overcome. Thanks, Mike. We'll just go on to the next slide. Yeah. Now, as we look at this, as like I said, everybody in here has mastered a technique to do it. But there are lots of different techniques that you could use. And the best way I can explain it to you, willing volunteer from the audience? Yes, please, sir. Up you get. With whom I have never worked. Yeah. And if we just take a boxing position. Yeah. Trust me, I'm all right. Right, fine. So away we go. Now, what you look at when you're boxing actually has some relevance to this. Consider you've got... Drop your hands a minute here. Consider you've got two visual systems... But don't... All right. Consider you've got two visual systems. You've got a foveal visual system, which is what you're looking at. And it's specialised. It's linked into your speech centre. And it's specialised for picking stuff. Evolutionary, it says, oh, that's a berry, I can eat that. That's a dinosaur, bugger me, run up, run like hell. Yeah? And that's how that works. And you've got a peripheral system. And the peripheral system is very good at picking up motion. Yeah? So when a shadow falls across you, oh, I'm not going to stop and check it's a Tyrannosaurus Rex. I'm going to run like heck. Now, when you go into the boxing situation, yeah, away we go, there's not much point to me looking at that front hand and going, it's a hand, because, I'm generally very perceptive, but I don't need to know that. What I need to pick up is motion. And so what I tend to do is I'll look at his shoulder, because now my peripheral system can pick up motion from his hands, this, that, and the other, whatever he's doing, and I'll just stay there, not because I'm looking at his shoulder, but because that gives my peripheral vision the best way to work. Make sense? Now, if all of a sudden we go from boxing to karate, two things happen. He can use his feet, so I step back a bit, and all I do look now at is I just look at his front hip, because again, I've got all of him there. Yeah, I can see his hands, see his feet, I can see what's going on. Thanks. Have a seat. Well done. So, thank you. Okay, so that's the system that you'd like to use. So what you'd like to do when you get into this sort of flash-like situation to overcome it is you'd like to use, it's more functional for you to use the peripheral vision. So I was chatting to a couple of the guys last night about the problem of, is that a no-ball foot position and then is that an LBW? Yeah, and clearly it's you're not going to go, hopefully, yeah? You're probably just going to go, just move your eyes. The problem is that when your eyes are moving, it's very hard for your brain to register what the heck's going on. So you're basically taking a snapshot of did his foot go, and you're taking another snapshot of is it online. Now, the extent to which you can start to train yourself to use peripheral vision to check that so that you're online here will actually improve your performance in terms of your accuracy. Now, the inaccuracies are going to be two types. You're either going to say that say he's in when he isn't, and say he's out when he isn't. So we've got gaps of inclusion and gaps of exclusion. Interestingly, when we start looking at the stuff that's been done in football from the World Cup, there are training methods that you can put in to improve this. Because what we see is that actually, as far as I can see on all the figures, and I don't know the actual numbers, ladies and gents, but I'm just, you know, a keen watcher of cricket, and it strikes me that you guys get this right a lot more oftener than these chaps do. Because we're talking about something like 15 to 20% errors of omission, errors of inclusion, saying he's offside when he actually isn't, particularly happening in the first quarter of a game. So it's almost like people need to get their eye in. So hopefully that makes sense. One of the ways in which you are peculiar is that you have mastered this technique of doing two things or more things at once. But all of you will have come up with a slightly different way of doing it. And so all I'm encouraging you to do is that perhaps there would be methods that you might consider, you know, you might like to train. This thing here was done with good class football linesmen and improved their accuracy of exclusion and inclusion by something like 20%. So there are little packages that you can put in there. But at the very least, consider what you're trying to do. And rather than move your eyes from one stimulus to another stimulus, try to use peripheral vision for at least one stimulus and keep your foveal, your central vision, for the other. Happy to take questions, but it's one way in which you are peculiar. And in this sense, peculiar is good. My second contention would be that actually, it might not feel like it, but umpiring is a team event. And it's not just a team event because there's two of you on the field at any one time, but it's also a team event because what you do this week is hopefully the same sort of thing as what you do the following week and you do the third. In other words, what the players are expecting is a clear arbitration of and consistent arbitration of a set of rules or laws. Now, there are all sorts of problems, again, because we're human beings, we're not machines, yeah? And there's only one person right in all the world, and I'm married to her. So what we need to do, oh, you're married to her as well. Must be bigamy. Anyway, never mind. So what we've got are a set of rules, a set of laws that we want to stick to, but then we've got all sorts of other challenges or pressures. We've got, firstly, official guidance on interpretation. Maybe that can be quite simple. Certainly in rugby, that's a big issue. You've then got some unofficial guidance. Your mates will chat to you and say such and such, such and such. The social milieu, the national style, again, the extent to which this happens in cricket, I would take advice, but certainly from football and from rugby, how you're refereed in the Southern Hemisphere, the Northern Hemisphere, how you're refereed in a South American context to a European context to a British context, tends to be quite different. And all of these are occurring off the same set of laws or rules, but they're occurring because of all these sort of social pressures that are acting on people. Finally, of course, there's the in-situation pressures. You've got the crowds, and they do affect you. They can affect you in either direction, yeah? You can be completely cussed and ignore them and go the other way, or you can be sort of swayed by them, coaches and players. But all of these different factors are impacting upon you. And therefore, what we need to try and do is to make sure that there's a consistent set of applications of this rules, laws, from person to person to person, yeah? Because I'm assuming that's what we want. We don't, the room for personal interpretation in the world of the umpire is reasonably low. Okay, so we wanted to have a look at that, and we wanted to have a look at some features of doing this in rugby. So what we did at the time was have the opportunity to do some video tests on a law that was causing all sorts of trouble. This is a few years back, so if you're current in rugby, the laws have changed again. Yeah, but what this is you sit there as a referee, we show you two situations and you judge what's going to happen and whether you're going to give a penalty this way, scrum this way, scrum that way, the other. Let's just run the tape, and there's two examples for you to have a look at. Thanks, Mike.
Gloucester versus Wasps. Wasps had the ball just outside Gloucester's 22, attacking to the left.
Delalio.
A little bit easy to see this one because someone starts tap dancing on him. Perfectly fair. Second one, slightly more subtle.
Leicester versus Northampton. Northampton have the ball just outside Leicester's 22, attacking to the left.
Bramall. Grayson.
Nice tackle.
Still keep it going, but Johnson, referee Hugh says, honestly.
Right, pick the bones out of that lot. And these were the sorts of things that we asked the, you know, the top 60 guys at the time to say, well, what did you get? Now, interestingly, the first one was pretty simple. So if you look at that, there's a number of different options they could have given. There's a very, very consistent response to that's a penalty to the attack. So this is a good one. Yeah? As a group, as a team, we're looking at a situation and you 1 week, you the next week, and you the third would have all refereed it the same way according to the laws. Happy days. The second one, I think the technical term for that is it's all over the bloody place. Yeah? Now, these are the sorts of things that lead players to send you white sticks at Christmas, ask to see your parents' birth, you know, marriage certificate, all this sort of stuff. You know, it becomes difficult. In actual fact, this little statistic down here, the Kappa statistic, is a measure of consistency. So if I go back to the first one, it's quite high. When I go to this one, it's more lower. And to be honest with you, that level of consistency, you'd get a better level of consistency tossing a coin. So this is a situation where, and do I mean by this that rugby referees are not very good? No, I don't. The rugby, the RFU had the balls to, sorry, pardon the expression, to actually go, no, let's check this. And I'd be pretty certain that if we checked particular sorts of challenge situations across sports, we would find different interpretations. Yeah? So what this is saying is there are certain circumstances in decision-making where there is a very clear rule, but the way in which that rule is arbitrated, interpreted, almost the way in which the different factors are weighted, you know, which is the most important factor in this situation? This one, how do I make judgments, are different. I want to draw your attention, ladies and gentlemen, to one other thing, which is this is the sort of the self-rated confidence level. So when it says the average confidence level, this is when you asked everybody, here's your situation, now rate yourself out of five. Five is you're completely certain. One is, no, you're not too sure at all. Where are you? So there's the first situation, 4.6. There's the second situation, which I've just explained to you is all over the bloody place, but the guys are still as consistently confident. Yeah? And that's a feature of being a referee or an umpire. A feature of being a referee or umpire is that you are either egotistical, yeah, bomb-headed, or confident enough to retain and say, no, that's my decision and that's what I'm going with, which is great within that competition, but not so great if the following week I get a referee who is equally confident in his or her decision, but they're looking at different things. So this is a feature of you that, again, is peculiar. You need to have pretty cast-iron confidence, but that cast-iron confidence can cause detriment. It can cause, you'd almost like to bite yourself in the bottom. Well, actually, what we wanted to try and do about that was we wanted to try and increase the consistency for this particular problem that had been allocated. So what we did was we did a little training video where they saw situations and had to check them out, and then they got an explanation as to what was going on. Yes, please, Mike. We've changed the orientation to a touch judge position because that was more sensible, and you'll see we'll blank out the referee so you can't see what's going on.
Clip B4, Bath versus Quinns. Bath with the ball progressing to the right.
This is you standing there as a touch judge, maybe talking on the talking flag to the referee and saying this is what you think it is. We've blanked it out so they can't see what his decision is.
Make your decision now.
Clip B4 clearly shows a Quinns player failing to move away on the ground after a tackle. Not only does he slow up possession for Bath, he also causes a potential flashpoint by just lying on the floor and not moving away. As referees, we should be very, very clear. If players are on the wrong side of the ball, if we don't blow up quickly and penalise them, players would take the law into their own hands. So we have to be positive and react very, very quickly in situations of this kind.
So what we've got there is, I mean, that's Ed, if you don't know him, that's Ed Morrison. He was at the time, he was a senior referee for the RFU, world-class referee. He'd done a cup final, you know, very, very good. And what he's offering is twofold. What he's offering is a sort of a role model, Yeah, someone that says, look, I'm a top referee, this is how I'm looking at it. But more importantly, he's saying to you, here is the weighting scale you should apply. In this situation, you should look at this, and this is the thing that's the biggest thing to consider. Now, again, with respect, I would suggest that the situations you face as umpires are slightly less dynamic, mostly, than the situations that football and rugby referees will face. However, they are still no less complex, and they still require this consistent weighting scale. So what I'm suggesting to you is that the best way in which we can increase the coherence from one umpire to another is for you to actually sit down and talk through, okay, well, what did you give there? Oh, I gave such and such. Well, why was that? You know, in other words, tease out the reasoning as to what went on. Check that the guy you're talking to actually saw what you saw or weighted it the same way you weighted it. And now all of a sudden we're starting to get some development. Now, interestingly, we've done the same thing with players, so that we found that players who are better class players, even though they've played less together, will be more coherent. Because what they'll do is they'll sit down and they'll have those conversations. They'll sit down and they'll talk to each other and say, okay, well, why did you do what you did in that circumstance? You know, what was going on? What were you looking at? What were the weighting scales? What were the factors? So pretty much this is almost like do-it-yourself CPD for umpires, yeah? Debriefing as much as you possibly can what's going on. And we'll come back to that later on. However, going back to your peculiar people, you have to have this bomb-proof confidence. It's just that, like any characteristic, it has strengths and weaknesses. It's very rarely that we have a personality trait that's great, yeah? It carries its pros and cons. Anyway, whipping through. Let's come into the next thing. Automated systems are coming into games. They're coming in a lot to games. And the problem is that they can help and hinder. And there's several ways in which they can help and hinder. And I'm sure you guys could wax lyrical on this. I'm just going to highlight a couple of three. When we've got something that's an objective source of information, we naturally tend to weight that more heavily. That's the sort of the natural tendency we have. So if a machine is telling us an answer, yeah, sort of computer says no type stuff, if a machine is telling us the answer, we tend to believe it, yeah? Unless we're cantankerous old bastards like me, in which case we completely disagree with it. But anyway, my point is that the weighting scale applied to such objective evidence, perhaps sensibly, but only perhaps sensibly, comes out. So now, that differential occurs for us as umpires, it occurs for them as players, and it also occurs for them as the media. So if you were to go back and watch the recording from the rugby league game England-New Zealand this morning, you would see a try get disallowed, probably correctly, but again, the weighting and the way in which that sort of information was used to give stick to the umpires is of interest to me. Now again, anecdotally at least, when I look at the performance of cricket umpires, I'm very, very impressed, because your levels of consistency, your levels of getting it right against this sort of standard are very high. But the problem is, and you might find this if you've been using a sat-nav, if you use a sat-nav all the time, your powers of navigation go out the window. All of a sudden, you find you can't use them. If you use this aid, your ability to make calls decrease. And so in actual fact, what you'd like to see are umpires having to make decisions and not just going zoom, 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 yeah, and absolving it, but having to make decisions. They might not even publicise those decisions, but put in those decisions up front and then considering using this as an aid, not as an answer. Now, you know, I'm coming at that from a psychological position. You guys might have different perceptions. Let's chat about it later. But in any case, what we've got here is a great example of a thing called confirmation bias. We know we've got a number of biases. Again, they're inherent within us. And this thing called confirmation bias, in a direction that says that we usually trust the machine more than we trust ourselves, or we usually distrust the machine more than we trust ourselves, it's a personality trait. It's a characteristic about yourself. So let's just have a look at a short bit of video about confirmation bias. Yes, please, Mike.
I'm going to give you guys three numbers, a three-number sequence, and I have a rule in mind that these three numbers obey. And I want you to try to figure out what that rule is. But the way that you can get information is by proposing your own set of three numbers to which I will say, yes, that follows my rule, or no, it doesn't follow my rule, and then you can propose what you think the rule is.
And I'd like you to do the same thing.
Yeah, okay, so here are the three numbers. 2, 4, 8.
2, 4, 8.
You don't need to continue the sequence. You can propose a totally different sequence, whatever you want to propose, and I will simply say yes or no, that follows my rule.
2, 4, 8. 16, 32, and 64.
Yeah. Those also follow my rule.
Okay.
What's the rule? What are you thinking?
Multiply by two.
That is not my rule.
What?
That's not my rule. But you're allowed, if you want, propose three other numbers.
3, 6, 12.
3, 6, 12.
Uh-huh. 3, 6, 12 uh-huh. follows my rule.
10, 20, 40.
10, 20, 40.
That follows the rule.
Yeah, I'm still multiplying by two.
I know. I know what you're doing. And yes, it follows my rule, but no, it's not my rule.
5, 10.
10 and 20.
Follows my rule.
100.
200. 400.
Follows my rule.
500, 1,000, 2,000.
Follows my rule.
Want me to keep going?
But do I just keep going? You're going to tell me your rule?
Am I doing it the wrong way? Am I approaching this the wrong way?
You're totally fine, okay. But you're approaching it the way most people approach it. Like, think strategically about this. You want information.
Yeah.
I have information. The point of the three numbers, right, is to allow you to figure out what the rule is.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to give you the numbers that I don't think fits the sequence and then see what you say. So I'll say 2, 4, 7.
Fits my rule.
So whatever I propose is right?
So is your rule like... You can propose any number. So the rule is anything we say is yes.
No.
Damn it.
But you are on the right track now. Hit me with three numbers.
3, 6, 9.
Follows my rule.
Oh, that didn't follow my rule.
This is good, right?
5, 10, 15.
That follows my rule.
What? Oh. Really?
Yeah.
I don't believe this.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
Follows the rule.
What about 7, 8, 9?
Follows. Yes, that follows the rule.
8, 16, 39.
Fits the rule.
Excellent.
But we're no closer to the rule. I want you to get to the rule.
How about 1, 7, 13?
Follows the rule.
What?
11, 12, 13.
How does this
follows
make sense?
Follows the rule. 10,
I don't
9,
know
8.
How to do this.
Does not follow the rule.
10, 9, 8 does not.
Oh, so is it all in ascending order?
Booyah.
Okay.
Up top. Yes, first ones to get it. You guys nailed it. That's the rule. That's the rule. Numbers in increasing order.
Aww.
Numbers in ascending order.
Oh, so much.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 15, 25. Doesn't matter. Any numbers in ascending order. I was inspired to make this video by the book The Black Swan by Nassim Taleb. Now, the black swan is a metaphor for the unknown and the unexpected. I mean, in the old world, the theory was that all swans were white. So each instance of a white swan would make you think, yeah, that theory's pretty good. But the point is, you can never prove a theory true, and in fact, when people found Australia, they realized that there were black swans. What was interesting for me was that everyone I spoke to came up with a rule very early on, and then only proposed numbers that fit with that rule they were thinking. I was looking for you guys to propose a set of numbers that didn't follow your rule, and didn't follow my rule. I was looking for you guys not to try to confirm what you believe. You're always asking something where you expect the answer to be yes, right? Like, you're trying to get at it.
Yeah.
But instead you want to get... The no.
You want to get the no because that's much more informational for you than the yes. Like if everything's giving a yes.
No, that is true. That is really true once you say that.
That is what's so important about the scientific method. We set out to disprove our theories. And it's when we can't disprove them that we say, this must be getting at something really true about our reality. So I think we should do that in all aspects of our lives. If you think that something is true, you should try as hard as you can to disprove it. Only then can you really get at the truth and not fool yourself.
Now, you might watch that and say that's conclusive evidence that North Americans are innumerate. Well, fair enough, okay. Probably they were all bankers, with the greatest respect. Let's go back one. Let's just think about that. Why have I shown you that? I've shown you that because it is human nature, and I'll re-emphasize this later, ladies and gentlemen. It's human nature to look for confirmation of what we believe. Yeah? It's evolutionarily sensible for us to come up with answers quickly. It's called satisficing. We come up with a solution that goes, oh, that'll fit. Yeah? So in certain circumstances, I think Bloggs is susceptible to LBW. I think Smith is actually throwing, not bowling. I think Jones, it, whatever. Yeah? And now what we will do, because of the way we're wired, and you could see here, these guys came very, very early, I've cracked it. And they were then very, very hard to shift. And I wonder how many of you sitting there actually went, no, bloody obvious, it's this. It's very, very hard to sort of shift gears and get out of a perception and into another perception. Make sense? Now, I do work with a lot of different players. So, for example, you might have seen the Winter Olympics. And at the Winter Olympics, one of our best medal hopes was disqualified for the same sort of thing three times in short track speed skating. And at the end, I remember her saying, oh, my sports psychologist said my luck should have changed by now, which is complete and utter tosh. Yeah? Because in actual fact, what's happened is that now the referees have got in their head, that girl cross tracks. She does this. She goes across in front of people. So now I'm going to look for it. Yeah? And we had a similar situation way back in at the Lillehammer Olympics, where the guy I was working with was disqualified out of the silver in 1,000. And what we had to do was to convince them that actually he was whiter than white, which of course he wasn't, but that he wasn't a cheating bastard. And so what we actually did was set it up so that in the early rounds, he let people get in front of him and cross-track him, so that all of a sudden the referee's eyes were drawn to someone else. Make sense? What we're doing is we're trying to play with your confirmation bias. I had the pleasure of working with a notable English second row who at the time was being accused of being a little bit naughty because he would always get into fights. And so what was happening, you know, you can guess who it is, I'm not going to say, but all of a sudden referees would look for it because their expectation was that this would happen, and even if he sort of, you know, and then people would start to play for it. Now, what we would do is start a fight in another part of the line out very early so that the referee... but it works, because what it does is it plays with your head as the referee, and now all of a sudden we can break that confirmation bias. So one of the things that I suggest to you is that, yes, you've got this bomb-proof confidence, and we've all got the bomb-proof confidence, but we've also got this tendency, which is evolutionarily sensible, to come up with answers quickly and then to make everything fit it. I'll come back to it later. But that's a challenge. What it means is that you have to be ready and prepared to actually accept that you're wrong. Yeah? It's something my wife tells me all the time. It's actually something my first wife told me all the time as well, but never mind, all right? So the point is that because of this confirmation bias, because of the tendency for you to look for the solution and then say, I've got the solution, now I'll massage the facts to fit it, yeah? I don't wish to be political, but watching George Osborne at the EU conference yesterday, someone somewhere is selling porkies, but we won't go into who. Anyway, moving right along. My fourth contention, bless you, my fourth contention, is it fourth? I'm going to put any number on it. Anyway, I think it's my fourth contention, is that if you're going to be good, you're going to be an elite athlete. You're not necessarily going to be an elite athlete in the sort of my body is a temple. I mean, clearly my body is a temple. Unfortunately, it's St. Paul's shaped. Yeah, you might have the same sort of problems. Now I'm this old, I spend a lot of time fighting pirate trouble, sunken chest. Yeah, I've always wanted to keep my bench, I've always wanted to keep my chest 10 inches bigger than my waist. And when you have the liking for beer and curry I do, that's a lot of bench press. But my point here is that the thing that makes elite athletes is generally a set of mental characteristics. What is here, a lot of the rugby stuff I've done here is from the work of a friend and colleague called Duncan Mascarenhas. And this is from the work we did originally in rugby, where people were asked, what is it that you think that is necessary to become a top-class rugby referee? And these were the figures. We've done this again in football, we've done this again in basketball, done it in volleyball, it's the same sort of thing. The main point for me is that as an overarching set of factors, we've got these, what I'm going to show you, the psychological characteristics of excellence, which are the things that make people good. And if you're going to be a good umpire, you've got these skills. If you're going to be a good player, you've got these skills. There they are. PCDEs, the psychological characteristics of developing excellence. And this shopping list, ladies and gentlemen, is very interesting because pretty much whatever area of human endeavour you look at, These things, tweaked to fit the situation, are the things that people need to be able to be good. So this discriminates between people who are almost Olympians and people who are Olympians, people who get a tour card in golf and don't, people who are professional dancers and who aren't, people who get places in conservatoires and orchestras and don't, leading stockbrokers, leading bankers, leading academics, leading sports people, leading referees, umpires, etc., etc. So in other words, if I had a, you know, part of the work that I do in talent development academies, and I have the pleasure of working in several, yeah, is this is our agenda, this is our mental agenda for the young players we work with. Because if they've got this lot, they will make the most of themselves. Whatever, even if they don't make it in football, if they decide to go and do something else, then all of a sudden they will use, they will deploy these characteristics to make them good. And my suggestion to you, ladies and gents, is that if you're going to be good, if you're going to be at the top of your profession, whatever profession you want to choose, it will be this lot that will take you there. And so therefore, in any training mechanism I want to get into, these are things I push, whether I'm doing military, whether I'm doing FCO, whatever I'm doing, because those characteristics work. Again, we can come back to questions later if that's handy. Okay, and my last point is to talk about rumination. Rumination is not bringing up grass, chewing it again, and farting lots. In this case, it's mental rumination. It's the extent to which you would run through things and think about things, yeah? And it's, again, a very natural thing for us to do. It's more a male trait than a female trait, yeah? It's potentially quite damaging. And rumination is not good, unless you do it in the right place, in the right way and the right time. So basically, sex, comedy and rumination, it's all about timing. Same thing here. So this is some Danish bloke, Hamlet. It's our interpretation of what happens to us that is the way we benefit. Yeah. If you'd like another quote from Aldous Huxley, experience is not what happens to a man, it's what he does with what happens to him. So just because you have done a number of high-level games, or you've had the pleasure of standing with another very good umpire, or you've gained certain experiences through your life, will not necessarily make a blind bit of bloody difference to you. What will make a bit of difference to you is the way in which you now think about, synthesize, take out the good bits and throw away the bad bits, yeah, from what's happened. In other words, rumination is not the baby. Yeah, we need to distinguish between rumination, which is generally negative. Yeah, oh my gosh, I wish I hadn't danced naked on the table at that, at the local cheese and wine do at the Vicars. Seemed like a good idea at the time. Our ability to replay stuff and just sort of run it through in our heads, our ability to then think about it a little bit and unpack it, called reflection, and what is the sort of the black belt third Dan standard, the gold standard that we'd like people to have, which is this thing called critical reflection. Now, critical reflection, you will hear talked about lots and lots and lots in sports settings. And it's an extremely important characteristic and a distinguishing characteristic of people who are good. So there's a small game of rugby going on this afternoon. Richie McCaw will write down a priori in a little old tattered notebook the things that he needs to work on that day. He will then evaluate himself afterwards in that book. That's what he does. And that is a feature, it's a characteristic of a number of world-class guys. And world-class guys who don't do that are not going to stay world-class for long. I would be that strong to do it. So what we're really after is the promotion of this thing called critical reflection. Well, how are we going to do that? How are we going to avoid the negative impacts of negative rumination and promote critical reflection? Just as an example, one good example of a study that shows that psychologists are gits was a study where they got people to imagine putting. And a group imagined putting the ball and it going straight down the hole, and they got 20% better at putting. Another group imagined putting the ball and missing 3 inches left or 3 inches right. They got 35% worse at putting. Yeah, and this is the bugger. Imagining yourself doing badly is more successful at making you do badly than imagining yourself doing well is at making yourself do well. Makes sense. Another feature. If all of a sudden I wired you up with a sort of a heart rate monitor or a blood pressure cuff, something that would tell me how aroused you were, and I got you to think about something that had been arousing, yeah, yes, even that. My problem is I know there's something I used to think about every 20 minutes, but I can't remember what it was, but never mind. But if I was then to look at the scale, yeah, the scale would blip when you were thinking about something bad. But if I asked you to imagine a situation or remember a situation where you made a complete arse out of yourself, as I look around, clearly some of you would have to ask someone else about that sort of circumstance. But if I ask you to do that, then I'll get a big reaction. The emotional loading, the emotional response of your body to imagining yourself making a complete mistake is much, much greater. And therefore the rumination is more impactful, yeah, than it is when you imagine yourself doing well. So just out of interest, you will see a batsman make a mistake. And then if they're any good, they'll then correct it two or three times. They'll do it accurately two or three times. Because if they don't, the negative, Christ, I shouldn't have done that, blah, 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 will get them out. They have to replace and groove a positive feedback, and they need to do it maybe three times as much for it to have an effect. Anyway, so having got that negative rumination is pretty damn negative, let's have a look at critical reflection and see what we can do there. I want to emphasise that this isn't natural. Critical reflection is not a natural condition. It's not something we pop out the womb doing. It's, and again, I'm not being rude, it's probably something that 35% on average of the people in this room will not do well. One of the effects of negative rumination are raised cortisol levels. It's the reason why we all die, you know, men, we all die early from circulatory conditions and things like that. Women tend to get the emotion out, which is why you use more Valium than us, but you last longer. Yeah, I know which camp I'd rather be in, but it's a bit too late to change. But my point here is that we're not good at this sort of reflection. We don't sit down and audit our thinking. We don't take an opportunity to say, right, I've just finished the day's umpiring. Now I'm going to sit still for 10 or 15 minutes and I'm going to run through it. I'm going to make notes about the good and the bad bits and then I'm going to put it away. Yeah? We either won't, or our rumination on it will be confined to the negative stuff and maybe to the trip home. We like decisive answerers. We like people who are decisive. Yeah, we like someone who gives us a black and white answer. But black and white answers are not, you know, they don't apply to human things. One of the reasons my company is called Grey Matters, not 50 Shades of Grey of it, but 50 Grey Matters, because you won't get black and white answers in humans. Yeah? So what we're looking at are shades of greyness. There's this lovely quote here, our brains are made for fitness, not for truth. Our brains are made evolutionarily to make quick decisions and to come up with these satisfying answers. And similarly, if we go into our ability to self-critique, to be able to sit back and go, well, how was that? How well did I do? Did I really get that taped in an unbiased manner? And again, this lovely quote, when faced with the choices between changing one's mind and proving that there's no need to do so, almost everybody gets ready with the proof. We don't take negative criticism well. We might internalise it and let it rattle around, but we don't do this. Now, I've had the pleasure of working in Special Forces, and I have the pleasure of working now. And let me tell you, you debrief the hell out of everything you do. When you do training, you do it, and then you debrief the heck out of it. Because if you don't debrief the heck out of it and squeeze every bit of learning juice out of that experience, then the next time you go on a job, you might get killed, and it looks bad on your CV. So what you tend to do is to be very, very motivated to focus. My suggestion to you, ladies and gents, is that this is absolutely crucial to forwards progress. It's almost like there should be a quiet time. You should be able to take, you know, the officials and put them in a room somewhere and say, okay, lads, let's just debrief that. Because debriefing it too late, yeah, and you start to lose your perspective on it. So it's something that, you know, you'd like to do. So what does critical reflection require? It requires someone who we can trust to give us a straight answer. Yeah? It requires someone who can audit our performance and turn around to us and say, this is where we are. It requires a commonly held criteria. They're probably called the rules of the game, against which we can judge. And also a commonly held lingo, a jargon, a lingua franca that we can toss back and forth. But we need to be able to discuss, ladies and gents, these decisions that we've made and measure them against these rules and then look for the mistakes and the other problems that come out. We need the confidence to be wrong, which, when you're an umpire and you feel that you've got to be right all of the time, is again, it's a bit of a mental clink of gears to try and do it. Maybe even the desire to try being wrong or to try out stuff and to say, let me try this sort of technique. Maybe the opportunity to have practice situations. For example, I'm suggesting to you that a more functional way of judging a ball, no ball, yeah, on a bowler and keeping your eye on there is to use your peripheral vision to watch for that. Now, that would take practice. If you've arrived at a situation whereby you go boom, boom, and you move your eye from there to there, this is more functional. This will be better. It'll be faster. It'll be more accurate. Trust me, I'm a doctor. It will. And I can show you it. But it'll take you longer to change it, and therefore you'd need to practice it and you'd need to learn it. But most importantly, we need the ability to stand back, to do this reflection, learn the bits we need to learn, and then put it away. Because there's absolutely no doubt, and I can show you all the evidence if you like, that the rumination, the negative rumination, the running through, geez, I wish I hadn't done that, that was stupid, la 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 la, will eat you and will damage you severely. And it's something that damages people in business, it damages people. Look, you're all enthusiastic, you're all keen about what you do, you're all passionate about what you do. And that passion is a two-edged sword, because that passion associated with negative rumination will put you in a box early, which I wouldn't like. So that's about it. What have I done? You are peculiar people. Hats off to you. You know, utmost respect. You have all sorts of abilities which are superhuman. Yeah? I don't mean you put your underpants on the outside, or at least not on a Saturday. But what I am saying is that you have the capacity to do two things at once. You have acquired methods of working, but be careful, because those methods might be suboptimum and it might benefit you to come up with some new methods. I'm suggesting to you that you are subject to all sorts of tendencies as humans. Confirmation bias, wanting to come up with answers quickly, but that actually what you need to do is to make sure that you adhere to some common standard, this legal standard, the laws. And finally, what I'm suggesting to you is that time spent improving your critical reflection skills against the sort of a backdrop of the characteristics of excellence will make you successful, much more successful as umpires. It'll actually make you more successful as human beings in any challenge agenda you'd like to try. Utmost respect to you, ladies and gentlemen, for what you do. The contribution to the game is immense. Thank you so much for having me, and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.
Well, I hope you got as much out of that as I did. And I've heard David speak many times, but always, so I've made some notes here. I mean, interestingly enough, you would want me to say that a lot of what we learn today will be taken on by our education people and put into the courses that we do. The whole bit about self-reflection is absolutely at the front end of what we're currently thinking about. Some of the people in the room, we're wondering about whether we do too much self-reflection in paperwork, too little self-reflection in paperwork, which is associated with our 1A course. So it's right at the sharp end of how we are actually thinking and dealing with our own education programme. Enough of that. There is an opportunity for questions. We do have microphones. We'll try and get the microphones to you. If you can traditionally just put your hand up if you'd like to ask a question, and I'll try and go around the room. First one here on the left-hand side, please, David. Is somebody over here wants to ask a question?
That goes through transition. Is that critical reflection is a over-talked about and underdeveloped skill, almost across performance environments. And I concur completely. You'll get a big bang for your buck if you work on that. Sorry.
I wondered if the psychology of the relationship between umpire and player is slightly skewed, unlike other places. Where, for instance, there isn't any instant kind of penalty that can be issued on field. And my wife will give you the example, really. She says, what do you mean you can't send them off?
I think that You see, it was interesting to me when I don't know if you could see the sort of the bottom end of that pyramid, but when we came to work in rugby, the two characteristics that they wanted, that they said were essential. Sorry, they said several characteristics were essential to be a top class referee, but two of them, knowing the laws and being fit, they were like precursors. You know, they were sine qua non. Of course you had to be fit enough, and of course you had to know the laws. But they weren't the discriminating factors as to who made it and who didn't make it. The people who made it, they started by calling it an X factor. And actually, of course, it certainly wasn't a Simon Cowell X factor. It was interpersonal skills. Yeah? And so what you actually need to do is to have the interpersonal skills to be able to work with people, to actually debrief them afterwards, et cetera, et cetera, to know where you're right or you're wrong. But that's essential. Yeah? So it's. I used to be in teacher education, and the first thing my beginning students used to know was, what can I do? How many detentions can I give them? Can I cane them? Can I do this? Can I, you know, can I use it? Can I use a chainsaw? No, calm down. Yeah? If you're good, if you've got the personality, you won't need that. And so my immediate thing is that actually, one of the things that you would look at is the umpire's interpersonal interactions with the players, and you'd work to develop that. Because that's the best tool you've got to maintain order, if that makes sense. Yeah? It sounds very simple. It isn't. It's complicated, and it takes work. And there's probably nothing you want to do less than to listen to some boring old fool tell you why he wasn't out, you know, in glorious detail. But giving some ear to that and actually giving some answer to that, I think repays you in spades. Comes back.
It's also a very apposite point, because you don't need me to remind you that in rugby and football, the assessment, judgment, performance of referees is judged by a third party, usually somebody watching from the sidelines or the stand. In cricket, in the majority of cases, your performance as stands are judged by the players in terms of the captain's marks that come in at the end of the day, which determine where you fit in your league panels, and whether we like it or not will determine an upward progression in certain respects. Although there's obviously lots of assessment and mentoring that comes in later in the day. So your question is absolutely from that perspective as well as the perspective that was asked.
And second question there. Unless your name is Helen Brooke and Collins, you won't be right all the time. Yeah? But you can at least have given the situation whereby you are willing to have this discourse. Yeah? And if they feel that they've been listened to, and they feel that something will change as you go forward. Of course, they might be completely wrong. You might be perfect. But at least listening to them and talking through it. Yeah, is an important part of that. Sorry.
It's okay. Yeah. Sir?
Yes, you've spoken about the laws and the rules of the game and the psychological aspects of that. But in cricket as umpires, we're also asked to apply something called the spirit of the game and the way in which the game is played, which has a strong sociological aspect to it. I'm just wondering what thoughts you have on that and how realistic is it for an umpire to be able to do those two things?
I think that's an excellent question, and you're right to highlight it. What I think you look at is you look at the sort of the sociological side from a formal and an informal sense. Yeah. So the sort of the mores, I don't mean large eels, the mores of the game and the sort of the spirit as you describe of the game, yeah, would be something indefinable that you would try and get through. I touched on it when I started to talk about the national tendency. But of course, what you need to do is to be consistent with the environment in which you work. Yeah. So, as a banal example, if you're umpiring an under a bunch of under sevens, yeah, you probably would allow a little bit more leeway and do a little bit more coaching as an umpire than you would if you're umpiring a county game. Yeah. Now that's an extreme example, but what I think there is that the spirit of the game and the way in which you're applying it is almost out in the open, and you're explaining to people, this is why I'm doing things the way I'm doing. This is the way I'm interacting with people around me, I think is an important part of addressing the issues that the other gentleman raised. Have I hit what you're after, or not quite?
Sometimes it feels like you're Canute holding back the antisocial behaviour sometimes, and you're just wondering if you're being how realistic you can be, or whether you're being ultra conservative at times.
See, I hate these second is the first loser t-shirts. What a heap of crap, you know. It's just complete nonsense. Yeah, you try to do the best you can, that's great. And as you are servants of the game, you're actually giving these guys a service, yeah? And as such, you supplicate to an extent your ego to giving them what's going on. And I think the rationale of turning around to these players and saying, look, I don't have to be here. This is where we are. You know, I mean, I only refereed football. I did my football referees qualification. I'd broken my jaw doing knockdown karate. So I went to the referee. And the first thought, I said, look, I got like, so you're not going to understand. Okay, fine. So the first time I gave a decision, I went, what's that, ref? 10 yards. You can't do that. Yes, I bloody can, and I'm going to do it all afternoon. And then we had a perfectly nice afternoon with me applying the 10-yard law from another game that we might know about, and they were fine, you know, once they'd finished taking the piddle. Mind you, I am larger than the average bear. But my point is that, you know, saying to people, look, let's have a rational. Some people are irrational. And if they're irrational, frankly, they should be out of the game.
Just to pick up your point about the spirit of cricket, you may know, Roger alluded this morning to the fact the MCC and ECB ACO are working, where MCC work with all boards, but they are looking at the actual wording, or will be looking over the next 2 years, the actual wording of the spirit of cricket, in order to make sure that it is completely relevant moving forward, given all the points that you've made, because we all recognise that the spirit of cricket in its fundamental widest sense is something which we must hang on to dearly at this time. Is there anybody at this side of the room? I don't want to be left-sided here, but if there's no questions over here, I'll stay on this side. Yes, okay, I'll stay over here. Yep, thank you very much, sir.
You mentioned earlier that one of the difficulties of an umpire, of course, is to identify no ball, and very, very shortly afterwards, there's a possibility of perhaps an LBW decision. And you also mentioned that people develop their own techniques in order to overcome this. But it's worse than that. It's more complicated because you also have the problem of the bowler running on the pitch, which is an event that occurs in between a potential no ball and a potential LBW decision. Now, again, it always happens. Everybody finds a way to deal with this. Generally, it would be by omission of one of the events to concentrate on one of the others. But as far as I know, there is no really best practice advice as to how to do this. Even though there is a best practice, there is a better way of dealing with it. So I'm just wondering, but that would be helpful for umpires to be able to practice and train at these particular things, if there was a written best practice for the very complicated issues like that, that nobody actually ever tells you how to do. It is there, you do have to do it. The very first indication of that, of course, for me anyway, is that I'm watching what's going on, all of a sudden there's a bowler in my way, therefore he's not where he's supposed to be. So then you have to deal with it. So getting best practice on how to do the difficult things and perhaps looking at it in a different way. I mean, the last newsletter, I wrote an article about umpire positioning at the bowler's end, which is quite different to what has been regarded as being best practice for, well, ever since the game began, really. Unfortunately, the wrong picture got printed, but we won't worry about that.
Sure.
Let David answer.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, in response, I have to say I don't know on cricket because I haven't checked it. And it may well be that that's a sensible thing for you to check. I do know that functionally, in terms of the equipment you've got, the hardware you've got, it is more sensible to allocate attention to what is going to be, you know, a sort of a harder challenge down here. It's how the eye movement's called a saccade. And it's how quickly the saccade occurs and how quickly you can refocus on what's going on. And it's a challenge. It puts a time loop in there. And the most sensible functional way to do it is to do this off peripheral and to do that off foveal vision. Yeah? Now, you've clearly come up with some tricks. You've mentioned that actually doing that, checking that, is at the exclusion of something else, which I find interesting. Yeah? But I think it would be very good to have some sort of evidence-based practice that says, here are the procedures. Now, the best example I can give you, if you look at the coxes in rowing eights, yeah, they're actually, there's a little bit more than sitting there swearing your head off and pulling some wires. It's a heck of a job. And these guys have to sort of, you know, they have a number of probably four or five different stopwatches running at once. They have different things to keep an eye on, et cetera, et cetera. And that's practiced. And there's an awful lot of coaching that goes into the execution of that technique. So I can only concur with you and say, I don't know the answer, but I do know that structurally, hardware-wise, you would be better using a mixture of peripheral vision and foveal vision. Okay?
It's interesting that the if you think about the slide we showed this morning as to why players are dissatisfied with umpires' performance, if you dig down to that, the most important thing they're dissatisfied with is our decision-making. They think we get too many decisions wrong, or that we are inconsistent in our decision-making. And that's not just LBWs and court short leg. That's giving wides, that's ground weather and light. That's everything about what we do. So decision-making is not just giving somebody out. It's actually all the other things around the game that we do. And your question is brilliant. In other words, for someone who's trying to be responsible for the education of what we give, how do we teach people to make better decisions? It's very, very difficult. So we're very good at the sort of things we've done today about preparing and making sure you self-reflect. How do we make you better? How do I make myself better at actually getting more LBWs correct, getting ground weather and light consistent with everybody else who's got the same ideas, making sure that the wide, my judgment of a wide is the same as everybody else's? And it is a very apposite question. And there is disagreement in the world of cricket as to whether or not you can actually just do nothing. You are going to make your decisions, and we can just prepare you to make them the best you can, or whether we can actually do something along the lines that we've been talking about today to make your decision-making better.
Just out of interest, I've shown you two training things today. The first improved performance by something like 20% in a bunch of professional football referees. The second one, the one where Ed was talking to people, improved performance by some consistency by something like 15%.
50%. I was part of that study. I was actually at that time, and we reckon, we were told, that our performance as a group of elite referees was up 15% by concentrating on certain aspects of decision-making, giving decisions. It's a different world. You can't really compare rugby, which is a very moving game, and cricket, where we're focused in a straight line. But nevertheless, it was interesting. Question here, we'll move on.
I wonder, do you have any thoughts or tips in relation to the relationship between trying to eliminate confirmation bias and pre-match preparation? I'm thinking of scenarios, for example, where you might in advance think of a strategy about how you might deal with particular players or particular things that are going to happen in the game, which I think is a positive thing to do, and how you stop that spilling over into presupposing that they would happen and acting inappropriately.
I think it's an excellent question. Because it's a fine line, isn't it? Yeah. To an extent, I mean, straight away, I'd be looking at the other umpire and saying, when we go and have a quick chat, I'd be saying, hey, what do you think? How was that? You know, was I a bit harsh there? Well, I'm not too sure. Blah, 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 blah. I'd come off and reflect it at the end of the session and just look at it. Yeah. If there was any video evidence, then I would be looking at that. If I knew I had a tendency with a certain player, yeah. I mean, Roy Keane springs to mind as a player with whom most bloody referees had something going on. You know, you would again, right, let me prepare myself to ensure that what I'm going to do. You've got to be careful you don't bend over too far the other way as well, yeah? So for me, the best way of improving decision-making is this idea of unpacking and going through the rationale as to why did you do what you did? What did you consider, yeah? Because there's a difference between competencies, which are the ways in which coaching, for example, is evaluated at the minute, which is a technique from hairdressing and bricklaying, so it's clearly, absolutely perfect for coaches, or looking at an expertise line whereby you say, now, I'm interested in what options you had. Why did you come up with? How did you weight the factors? Yeah, and I think if you're doing that and teasing out this rationale, that's the best way to tread that fine line.
We'll have two short questions and two short answers to wrap up. One here, please, and then followed by one here. Thank you very much indeed. And then I'll just talk to you about any other questions that you want to give after that. Thank you.
There is a principle or a word called equilibrium.
I've lost you. Where are you? Oh, there you are. Right, okay.
Yep. Judges and teachers and parents, they tend to side with the underdog. And there are cases in the cricket ground where sometimes we tend to side with the youngster who is batting or the bowler who is struggling. To what extent is equilibrium influence an umpire's decision.
So just to clarify,
To what extent does equilibrium affect an umpire's decision? In that sometimes you go with the underdog, there's a perception that someone might be an underdog within
the
game.
And I think that's a very, again, the spirit of the game sort of come out. I think you have to be careful, and it's almost like up front, we need to know, how am I going to work here? Yeah, am I going to work to try and maintain balance and give us a good game, or am I going to be the fair arbiter of the law? Because otherwise the whistle's going all the time, or your finger's going up all the time, and people are going, look, this is ridiculous. But right up front, I'd be talking to the team captains or the managers and saying, now, how should we do this? Again, we would have a common, coherent sort of view as to, at this level, in, I don't know, the Northern League Division 3, this is the principle of umpiring here. When we get into the county game, this is the principle of umpiring. So that's how I would do it.
And the last question, sir, here, please. Thank you.
Yeah, the question I have is it a point that we're doing too much of critical reasoning,
yep,
which is based more on the perception of peer and player pressure rather than us actually evaluating ourselves? If so, what are the corrective steps one should undertake for that?
And I think you've picked out what I would want as the take-home message from today. There are all sorts of pressures that are acting on you. Yeah, to imagine that those pressures don't hit you, yeah, is to imagine you're inhuman. Now, I've been refereed by a few inhuman referees in my time, not you, sir. But what you have to get to is a situation where you have to recognise, no, I have to step back from that. Yeah, and I am encouraging this. I'll sit down, I'll reflect. Sometimes I will be swayed by a player. I need to avoid it like the plague. Thank you. Excellent questions.
Thank you. Can I just say again, a bit like with the AGM, we've run out of time. I'm aware that there are more questions. If you have a question that you want to put to David or to me, write it down, and I promise you that one of us will respond either directly today or in email. So just make sure you put your email and put the question to us, and we'll make sure that you do get an individual response.
But if you are going to do that, I'm a prop forward, so use short words, please.
Well, what have we taken? I just made a few notes. We talked about decision making, not just the LBWs. We've talked about DRS. I love that phrase, that used as an aid, not as an answer. Perhaps not relevant to too many of us here, but what a fantastic way to go forward. When we talk about DRS, we perhaps talked to Ian Gould about that this afternoon. The looking for bias, the importance of confirmation and self-fulfilling prophecies. We think this bloke's a good player. We got 100 last week, or he's the captain of the side. Does that influence the way that we've been? This bloke's a difficult player. We know he's, so we'll deal with it in a different way. The question Matty asked, you are elite athletes. And you're not elite athletes because your body's a temple, but because you have the mental, psychological characteristics of excellence, which are on the screen, and of course, which we will produce in the DVD that will come out following this, that you can follow up. And most of all, for me, that point that David made about critical reflection, whether we're doing a test match or whether we're doing a third team game, is so important if we want to improve. As I said at the beginning, I myself got a huge amount from that. I hope you did too. David, thank you very much for your time. Please let us show our appreciation.
Thank you. Thank you very much.